Okay, so first process is the requisition, and the next process is the RFQ, request for quotation, and the request for quotation will be sent to the various suppliers, supplier 1, 2, and 3 as multiple suppliers it will be sent. Then the supplier will return with quotation. So the quotations, as we discussed in the previous class, it can be partly quoted or it can be fully quoted. So once all the quotations given by the supplier, then we'll go for the quote analysis. So this quote analysis will be done by the buyer. What buyer will do, he will club all these three requests for quotations and make one analysis. Because some supplier may give you in USD, some may give you in INR, some may give you in Euro. So all those values need to convert into one single currency to make the comparison. So those all those activities the buyer will do. Some vendors can give you a partly quantity, some may give you a full quantity. So all those things, the quote analysis will be done. So once the quote analysis is done, prepared, he will give it to the procurement director. Then he will take action on that one. Based on this one, now they will identify the price and the technicality. Fine. So normally this term, different companies may have different naming convention. So normally L is for the lowest price and T is for the technical evaluation. So this will be done first by the business. They will evaluate technically. They will say, they will value the vendor. They will say this vendor is best, this is second and this is third. And then procurement will see the prices and they will come back with the L1, L2 and 3. Which supplier has given least price, which has given the next least, and which has given the highest price. So L1 is the lowest one. 2 is little bit higher, L3 is more higher. So that way they will check it. That way they will check it. From this one, L1, L2, and L3, they will decide which supplier to be awarded. So what is the award? Award is nothing but it comes before the purchase order. It is called award. Fine. What is award? Award is an intimation to the successful vendor. The company will intimate, yes, okay, everything is fine. You got the proposal and we approve your quotation and we are going to prepare you the purchase order. So in the award, we'll say we are okay with you and we will give you order, okay? But this is not the legal document. We are just showing our interest, like we are going to go ahead with you. But this is not the final document. The final document will be the purchase order. Okay. So award will be intimating, pre-intimating to the vendor to make him start working towards the project. Then if it is a long-term project or it's a services or it's a material, something the supplier need to start arrangement. So what happens many time after between this evaluation completion and the purchase order approval, it will take months and months to complete. Like for example, if there's a ministry projects, then like say if some construction projects are there, real estate companies are there, if some big construction companies are there, their contracts are there. So it will be around one PO will be around 10 million or sometime it is 60, 70 million also. So that approval hierarchy goes up to the government authorities and from the company, out of the company, so many people will approve those type of transactions. So that will take from 1 month to 3 months. Okay. They'll start the minimum is 1 month and the maximum is 3 months or based on the countries and based on the policies, it will stretch for the longer time. Okay. So they give the award to close the cycle that we are going to give you the purchase order and you are the successful vendor. So now here you can see we have three vendors, S1, S2, and S3. Fine. So now what will happen? They award to, say, example, awarded to the supplier 2. Now the supplier 1 and 3, they are like not selected, but they will not share the decision with them. They will keep them on hold. They will say, decision under making, just hold on. Why? Because from 1 month to 3 months, things may change. When it reached to the final destination, the final person or the committee who has to take the decision, they may totally say, okay, you might have done any evaluation or whatever, based on some other constraints or whatever, I want to go with this. Okay, so that time you have to say, okay, we are going to revert back our award, we'll not give you, and we are going to give it to the supplier. 99% it will never happen, it will go with this one only. But possibilities are anything, any in this world anything can happen. So that's why award is not the final commitment. They cannot revert back after giving the PO. Once they give the contract or the PO, then this will not happen. They will not come back and say, no, it is not with you. Okay. So once they give this purchase order, when they issue the purchase order to this particular supplier, then they will send the rejection letter to the other suppliers. Fine. They will give the rejection letters to the other suppliers, like we have selected some other vendor and this time you are not selected. Best of luck. Fine. So with this one purchasing cycle done, what will happen from here now? The next process is the receiving process. Once the services or the material, the order is given to the supplier, then the supplier will send the material. And once the material received, then the requester, the person or the department who requested for the service or material, they have to make the receiving. Fine. Now during the receiving process, what is the mechanism? Now in this process, there are things to be considered. One is like services, and the other one is material. I hope voice and screen is fine. Let me know. Okay. Yeah, after 5 minutes, 10 minutes, just say okay. So just for me to make sure that things are moving fine. Okay. So when receiving, there can be a service or there can be material. Now, when you're receiving the service, so service can be directly received and closed, which means service, usually there is no inspection for service, right? Like for example, if you are doing an audit, so you just go and perform an audit. There is no inspection on the auditor's work, or nobody is doing the audit or any checking things there. But whereas in material, you need 3 steps. You need receiving, you need inspection, and you need delivery. Fine. So for the material, what are the different stages we have? Receiving, inspection, and the delivery. What does it mean? Receiving means, like say, for example, if it is a material, you will sometime, if it is a one laptop, it may directly come to the user desk. But say sometime if it is a construction company and they send any one trucks of blocks, or if they send say cement of 1,000 bags, something, so that's not going to come directly to the user office, right? So somebody will receive it at the construction site, ship to site, we called it. It will come at the ship to site. What is ship to site? Is we always have a different ship to site and a different bill to site. Bill to site where business people sitting and doing the accounting and you know, coordination, all of this work. And ship to site is where material is required to be shipped. So if construction is happening, so material is required to be shipped at the construction site. Okay, so they will ship it there. So the people will receive it here. Okay, and then after the receiving, they will perform the inspection. So inspection is like checking any the quality, if it is given as per the agreement or not. So inspection process will be done. So inspection for the straightforward, there will be simple inspection. But if it is a chemical company or something like construction company, different type of inspection, there will be a different separate department will be there. So that's inspection department will only be processing the inspection on the material which is coming in. Like for manufacturing, it is very critical. Like if you are doing a tiles manufacturing, so all the raw material which is coming in, so that all need to be tested. So after they finish the testing, then only they will send the material to the warehouse. So delivery means you are sending the material from inspection. Once the inspection is cleared, sometimes they take 5 days, sometimes 10 days, depend on the depending on the nature of the inspection. Once they give the certification, then this material will coming to the warehouse. Then it will come to the warehouse. Now from the warehouse, they will start using it for the consumption. Okay. So this is the process of receiving. So inspection for the material is required. In case of manufacturing, it is mandatory. In case of general companies, they usually do like quantity check, if it is broken or not broken, or any configuration and stuff. So it will not be very deep inspection will be there. And after that stretch, you will do the delivery. Delivery, once it is done, it will increase the stock level in the your inventory. And from there, it will be available for the sales, the other cycle, the sales order, shipping, ship, all those, receivable part, what you call order to cash. Okay. So material and things will be available from here. We'll discuss this one in detail. So now, what next? Receiving process. So I'll just make it clear. Receiving. So we have then inspection. And then we have. Fine. After this is done, what next? So at the delivery stage, at this stage, now at this stage, what will happen? The supplier will also send the delivery note to be signed by the people who are receiving this one. Okay, those delivery notes will be sent to the finance, and then here the invoicing process comes in. The supplier will send the invoice. Invoice I've already written here. Fine. So what is duplicate? Receiving and then invoicing. Now invoicing. Now for the invoicing purpose, what will happen? Invoice will come to the AP department. Basically, it will be a part of the finance department. So So inside the finance department, we'll have one department, sub department, they call it as a function. So one function will have it for the AP, one function will have for the cash management, one function will have for the receiving, one function will have for the fixed asset. This is a general structure. The company to company, it may change. So this AP department people, they will receive the invoice. Now, what is their job? AP people will only deal with the invoice. Invoice, credit memo, and debit memo. These three documents, it will be read by the AP department. And this is your AP module. In application point of view, it is your AP module. And from your accounting point of view, it is the AP department, accounts payable department. Fine. And these people will only deal with the invoice, credit memos, and debit memos. Fine. Now, what is an invoice? Invoice is nothing but a claim from the supplier for the money. For the services or material, whatever they have given, for that one, they will give a claim. So that paper is called an invoice. It's nothing but an invoice. Okay. So that invoice, once it comes to the AP accountant, what he is supposed to do, he has to perform some checking. What checking he will do, if suppose the quantity on the invoice is saying 100, fine. So then he will see if it is delivered 100 or not. Fine. If this and this matches, then he will approve the invoice. Fine. They will approve the invoice. If this quantity matched, then only he will approve the invoice. Now, what is the meaning of approving the invoice? Means this invoice is okay to make the payment. Fine. So once he approved the invoice, now this document will go to the next process called payment. This module we need to discuss because many of the SCM consultant in the market, people when I discuss and you know we work together, they avoid this module. They feel it is the part of the finance. AP is the part of the finance. But what happens is, it is a part of the finance, but you are very much involved because you are dealing with the procure to pay, which means you have to deal it till the payment is done. You cannot say my work is up to purchasing an inventory module. Fine. So we have to deal it till the payment process. Once the payment is done, then finance people will take care for the general ledger and other stuff. So make sure don't stop your the practice or your knowledge area up to the purchasing an inventory module. P2P O2C involve two finance module. One is for the payment payables and one is for the receivables. Okay. So now from this point, what will happen? Once they approve the invoice, it will move towards the payment process. Okay. Now, what is the purpose of credit memo and debit memo? Okay. Now, suppose if this here he sent the material 100, supplier given you the deliver the quantity 100 here, and based on this one he sent the invoice immediately. Now, during the inspection people will say 80 are okay, and 20 take that. Fine. So here in the delivery, what will happen? Only 80 will be delivered, and the 20 will be sent back to the supplier. So the supplier don't know by this time that this material is rejected. So what will happen? If this invoice come to him, he will see the invoice quantity is 100, and the rejected quantity is already there, and 80 quantity is only delivered. Then he will not approve the invoice. He will contact to the supplier. He will say, sorry, you send an invoice for 100, but there is a rejection of 20, which we have sent it to you, right? Then this credit memo come into the picture. Okay, what supplier will say? Okay, no need to cancel that invoice. I will send you a credit memo. You can use it with my invoice. Okay, and you can pay me back. Fine. So what it will do? It will reduce any when you are making the payment for this particular invoice. It will show you 100, and you will it will show your credit memo as 20. And only 80 quantity will be available for the payment. So during the payment process, the guy who is making the payment, he will do this process. He will apply the credit memo against the invoice, and he will make the payment for the 80. So this way, the credit memo and the debit memo help in the transaction. Both of them are negative invoices, and it used to reduce the invoice value. Fine. Now this process will be done by Treasury Department. Okay, and these are two different sections. This function will be different, and this function will be totally different. Person who is making the invoice is not allowed to make the payment. As a general rule, from audit point of view, control point of view. So the people who deal with the invoices, they don't have access to make the payments. Fine. So this will be dealt by the Treasury Department, or in application point of view, this is called cash management module. Because they know how much money is there and how much is to be paid and all. So they will, how much money is there and all. So they will send it to the, they will make the payment as per the cash availability and stuff. They will schedule what day the payment should go, and everything will be done by them. So they will make the payments here. Once the payment is done, there are a few sub process. Better we'll discuss that as well. There is something called, okay, now there is something, one more process at this level is called prepayment. With the name we understand that it's a payment part, but no, it's a kind of invoice. Prepayment is a kind of invoice. So what is a prepayment? Prepayment is nothing, it's a request to pay in advance. It is also an, you will, when the supplier will send you, when the supplier send you the invoice, when he's sending the prepayment, he will also send you the invoice after some time. Okay, prepayment comes in advance before the invoice. So this one, in the business terminology, we call it as a pro forma invoice. Okay, pro forma invoice or sample invoice or draft invoice or whatever we call it pro forma invoice, which is like a request to make the payment in advance. So it's called a prepayment invoice. Okay, now after the prepayment invoice, we will receive actual invoice. So this prepayment invoice will be paid as a normal payment. As a normal payment, this will be paid. Once it is paid, my spelling is very bad. Once this invoice, once this proforma invoice is paid, on a later stage, people, the supplier will send the actual invoice. Now we need to close this actual invoice, right? So for closing that actual invoice, how we do? Now this is standard invoice closure. When you make the payment, it get closed. But for the actual invoice, when we have to close this invoice, we cannot make the payment because it will be duplicate because we already paid to him. So what we call prepayment application. Prepayment application. So what we do with this invoice and this invoice, both of them we joined or we applied them on the, during the invoice process in the system. We'll see how to do that one. When you make this process, then it will be prepayment application will be done. Any user will be applying the prepayment on the invoice, then this invoice, the actual invoice will be closed. Okay, so this stage up to here, it's the end of the P2P cycle. Which is secure to payment. Okay. So at this stage, we'll stop for some time to see if we have got any question. Yes, dear. Anybody has any question, they can ask me because now we will move to some other topics. Okay. So up to here is the complete procure to pay transactions we have discussed. No questions. Okay. This is called the transaction flow. So what we have seen up to now, as we said, if you need to be a good consultant, if you need to be a, you know, work independently, then there are certain areas you need to be very good, okay, which you cannot avoid. Otherwise, you'll be dependent on somebody's help to complete your work. So the first thing what is required to be known is the configuration, and we agreed, like we will discuss the configuration at the last stage, because you need to know a lot of theory. Once you are done with the theory, then we'll get into the system where we'll see the configuration part. Okay, the first thing is required to be known is the configuration. Second thing is the transaction flow. So transaction flow, now we discuss all of these transactions flow one by one. What comes first, what comes next, who do these transactions, and what is expected outcome at each stage, what are the controls we have discussed, all of these processes we have discussed. So we are done with the transaction flow. Fine. What next? The third is the accounting. The third is the accounting, but I'm not sure if you guys are not from the commerce background, so it will be a bit difficult for you. But if you are from the commerce background, you can easily understand. So accounting point of view, in procure to pay, okay, now in procure to pay we have like on the purchase order there will be no accounting unless we use the budgets and stuff. Normally there will be no accounting. Then we have the PO and then receiving all the transactions like RFQ and requisition and everything. There will be no accounting process because no business transaction happen, and we are not making any payment or anything. That's why there will be no accounting. So when you raise the requisition, no accounting. When you raise the RFQ, quotation, then quote analysis, and then PO. And then code analysis, and then PO, and then receiving. Fine. Now this one, no accounting, no accounting, no accounting, no accounting. There's a budget accounting will be there. It's a different thing we'll discuss. But now for the main accounting. The receiving process, at the time of receiving, there will be accounting will be happening. Now, when we talk about the accounting for these modules, there is a concept called accrual. So on a high level, I will explain you what does it mean, because this is the core, this is the life of the software. This is the life of the application. If you are weak on this one, then doing all this good transaction flows, all these processes and controls and everything will be wasted. Because the end result is always the accounting. How good you are doing the process is matter if I'm getting the required balance sheet and if I'm getting the required P&L from the system. Because the final management, the CFOs, CEOs and all, for them only numbers will go. They are least bothered about this control. Okay, these are like manager level, they are responsible for this one, but for the CEO and CFO, these people will only get the balance sheets and the P&L in their hands. So if that is not properly taken care, then we'll struggle. So what is accrual? So we'll have the receiving accrual, we'll have these two accruals we have. One is the receiving accrual, and then one is for the AP accrual. AP accrual we have two. We'll discuss this one. Now, receiving accruals, I'll not go into the debits and credits and all. On a high level, this accrual concept I'll explain you. What is the meaning of accrual? Accrual is nothing but it is summing up and keeping it in a temporary account. What is this temporary account? Now, in the receiving process, as we discussed, we have the first stage as receiving, and the last stage we have delivery. Okay. What happens at the delivery? Your stock account will show, will be, what you can say, your stock account will increase in value. Fine. Suppose, for example, today your inventory value is 1 lakh. Now, after making this transaction, you make the transaction for 50,000, let's say, and you deliver 50,000 here, then it will become 1,50,000. Fine. But now, before this stage, we have a stage called inspection. Fine. With this inspection stage, what's happening? We may accept or we may reject it, right? So this value is hitting at this level only. So we can look, suppose if user has done only receiving and there is no delivery here, so we cannot increase the inventory value. But material is received, somewhere it needs to be accounted. Correct? We cannot say like we haven't received, because he actually dropped the material in our premises and he left. So the stock is with us. So what we do, once we do this receiving, till we accept the material, we keep it in the temporary account. It's called inventory receiving accrual. In the setups, this is one of the mandatory account which we are going to discuss. So what is the inventory receiving account? It will store this value of 50,000 here till we increase this value. Okay. Now from this area, if you reject, then it will go back to the supplier. If you accept, it will come down here. Okay. So once you accept the material, then it will increase your, it will come to the delivery portion. And from here, it will be added to your inventory. Okay. So why we called it as accrual? Because all the receivings you are doing here, maybe 10,000, 5,000, 3,000, all this will be stored into this account. We club it all and it will keep into one, this single account. That's why we called it as an accrual account. And it is temporary account, because once it is delivered into a stock account, it will become zero. So what happens here, we receive 50, it is showing here 50. Once it comes here, then it will become zero here. Okay. So accrual account always is tends towards going towards the zero. It will keep on increasing, it will keep on decreasing. Okay. So that is the concept of the inventory accrual account. Now, same way we have the API accrual. What is API accrual? API accrual is a concept called accrued liability and liability. What is the difference in these two? So basically, liability is something you have to pay. Okay, this is the liability of your company which you have to pay. Then what is the accrued liability here? Okay, now what happens is, when you are making the accounting balances and stuff, liability is the portion of the invoices received. Fine, liability is nothing but it is a portion of the invoices received. Now what will happen, there will be some rich supplier, they will not send you the invoices immediately. Suppose the service is given and the invoice not yet came to us. Fine. So all this delivery and all this stuff is done. We accepted the material inspection, everything is finished, but the supplier is late in submitting the invoice. Maybe it's due to some reason, or there is also payment terms. We say 30 days, 90 days, 120 days. Which means they will send invoice or will make payment after so many days. That okay, that will work with the invoice and payment. So what will happen in this? Now let's say the invoice has not reached to the supply, the invoice has not reached and it is in the receiving area. So this receiving received but invoice is not given. You say it is not payable at this stage, and material received invoice not received. So this stage is like material is received but invoice is not received. So we all those kind of transaction will keep adding up into this accrued liability. Okay, so in your reporting portion you will have liability and accrued liability sum up and showing it somewhere in your liability side. Fine. So this accrued liability will also keep zero, then it will keep increasing and decreasing all the time. Fine. Whenever there is a material received, automatically this will increase. Whenever an invoice came from the supplier, you match it to the purchase order, it will become zero. So always accrued liability will be going up and low, and it will be ultimately, if all the received, all the invoices we receive, then it will become zero. Okay, so this is one of the concept of the accrual, which you need to keep in mind when you're doing the configuration, because they will ask you different accrual accounts, so which is not possible. By default, you will have only one liability account to be given at the AB setup level. Now, if there is a requirement to have multiple liability accounts, then some different configurations need to be done. You may need to modify subledger accounting module, or you can do it with AP also with modifying some some standard configurations. We can achieve that one. So all those parameters will be based on the dependency is on the understanding this concept. If you know well where to configure, then you can do that one. Okay, so that is the accrual concept come into picture. What else we have? Closing process. This also falls under the accounting process, because during the accounting only the accountants they close the modules, they close the process. So how the sequence will go? Okay, we will find a lot of standard documents on the Metalink, and if you Google also, you can get a lot of closing process. This is also one of the weak area where not many consultants know how to do closing. Okay, because they believe up to the configurations, the job is done. But all this is very important. What the closing process is, you must know how to close all these modules. Okay, what is closing? Closing every month it is performed. It is performed every month. So it is also called month end closing. Okay, so during the month end closing, what will happen? All the transactions need to be accounted and transferred to manager. What we discuss all here, like all this in P2P, we have all these transactions. Invoice, sorry, PO receiving, AP we have invoice, and AP we have payment. All these things need to be accounted. And what is the purpose of the accounting? Finally, end of the day, we have to send it to the general ledger module. Okay, just a minute, I'll be back. 1 minute, I'll be back. So, my voice and screen all okay, right? Okay, guys. Now, all the transactions that need to be, all these transactions what we discuss here need to be accounted, and finally it will be sending to the general ledger module. So those accounting process, we need to follow some steps one by one. We need to do this one. Okay. What we do basically, there could be, you know, various ways for doing it. Any modules you can close here and there, and there is also, you basically follow the standard Oracle steps. Okay. Now they have given according to the sequence, like you have to make sure all the transactions are approved, POs and requisitions are approved for the time, and then they will see the same way. They will see all the receiving. The user will need to make sure all the receivings are done. Then AP people will make sure all the invoicing are done and stuff. So because here in the AP, they have to create, when they do the create accounting, it will generate the liability stuff. So liability generation will not happen unless the valid invoices are entered. So for validating the invoices, they need to make sure all the receivings are done. User, sometime they receive the material, they don't enter it in the system. So that type of, you know, they do follow up at the end of the month. The last three to five days, this will be happening between the departments. Okay, make sure this is receiving done. We have the invoice, it's not showing the system. So all, you know, to and fro things will be going on. So basically, from here, all the sequence, they will complete all the transaction steps. Once the transactions are done, then they will start creating the accounting entries also in the same flow. Now, if you are interested, if you guys are accounting background, on a later stage when we actually do it in the system, we'll see how the accounting is creating and what are the debit credits are hitting, what is going to the general ledger. For now, for the understanding purpose, it will create all the accountings, and then it will send it to the base general ledger module. Okay, so you can follow the standard Oracle procedure. Fine. There is a standard procedure for from Oracle what to how to do the month-end closing. Now, once you are done with the closing, you have to. There is a list of. So you have a number of reports to be run before you do the closing from each of the module, and once you've done all those closing, then you will start. You will open the next accounting period. Then people will do the transaction in the new accounting period. Okay. Now, what next? The next process is called reconciliation. Now, during the reconciliation process, this is not part of the SCM guide, but this will be done by the finance. Okay, finance department, because the transactions are from SCM, like your receiving is from SCM, purchase orders are from SCM, and invoices are from like P2P and stuff, they will keep bothering you. This is not matching here, that is not matching there. So now there will be always conflict because these people will talk accounting. And we don't spend much time on understanding the accounting flow and how it happened. So this area is always, you know, conflicting part between the IT and the finance. So there is very minimum accounting steps. If we spend some time, we can understand the logic to make sure how these people do the reconciliation between this one. So reconciliation, for now, I'm just giving you names for that. What is the process for that? How the detailed things we can discuss later on. So reconciliation happens. Reconciliation within the module, then reconciliation with vulnerability. Right? So there is two type of reconciliation. What they do within the module, they make the reconciliation. Means like if you talk about inventory, they will see what was the opening balance at start of the month, what was the quantity. During the month, how much we receive, during the month, how much we return, and then what is the remaining balance. So they'll make sure all those reports are showing the right values and showing the correct accounting values. So this is one of the way of checking the inventory module reconciliation. Then they will reconcile it with the general ledger. What is reconciling with general ledger? Suppose inventory module is showing a stock as 1 lakh, then general ledger should also show the same 1 lakh transaction. Why it may show you different? Reason. From one module to the another module, data will go through the interfaces. Data will be going through the interfaces. So during this process, every month you will have something got stuck in the interfaces with some errors. Sometime maybe the accounting periods are closed before the time. Sometime transactions are not matching. Sometimes people will try to update transaction from the back end and it is not properly updated. So we'll always have the differences when the data is traveling from, you know, sub ledger to the main ledger module. So this need to be fixed, and this always have to keep, you know, zero difference. Then only your system is perfect. So all this drive is to bring this zero. If you're able to bring this zero, then done deal. We make the achievement what we are doing all. So up to this zero, we need to understand how the process start, how the process is in, what accountings happen, how data transferred, how accounting get transferred, how it is calculated, and how the difference becomes zero. If the difference is zero, then your process is fine, your module is fine, software is fine, everything is very good. Fine. So this is called the reconciliation process. This is it. So from P2P theory point of view, I think we have discussed a lot, and we are working on the system. We are arranging the environment. So basically, I need to perform a testing on the environment. That's why we are delaying. So once the system is ready, we'll start doing this configuration and stuff. The next cycle we can discuss meanwhile would be the order to cash. This is also a part of SCM modules because it involves your inventory and order management. So it involves the order management. So here we have the first module as कॉल पे था मैं और एक कॉलीग है हाँ ओके ओके एंड द सेकंड मॉड्यूल इज इन्वेंटरी और नेक्स्ट मॉड्यूल इज Okay. This is a simple modules. Other modules based on the nature of business and stuff, other modules may come into the loop. But in order to cache, generally these are the three modules we discuss. So we inventory point of view. Okay, we'll discuss this one. So I want to stop today's session here, and because it's a fresh cycle order to cache cycle. So we can start this one from tomorrow. So with this one, by now, any questions? I'm happy to answer.